गुरुर्ब्रह्मा गुरुर्विष्णु गुरुर्देवो महेश्वरः गुरुरेव परं ब्रह्मा तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः come to the point where Nachiketa has come to the abode of the Lord of Death and there had to wait for 3 days, and when the Lord came back, he was made known, it was made known to him that there is a pious person, a Brahmin person, an educated person, a cultured person, boy, who has been waiting at your doorsteps for last 3 days and nights. And immediately the Lord goes to him and apologizes to have for making him go through these 3 nights without food and drink, and immediately to you can even say as a repentance gives him 3 boons and asks him, please take 3 boons, and bows down to him. And requests him, may good befall me. What good will befall God of Death? So in our culture, in the Hindu tradition, Sanatan tradition, I shouldn't say Hindu tradition, to be a good human being, the Sanatana Dharma is eternal religion, and that is talking about how to be a good person. So to be a good human being, you must respect the guest. That's a sign of cultural advancement. And once he has got this, now in the 10th verse, he asks, the boy asks the first boon. He says, Shanta Sankalpa Sumana Yatha Syat Vita Manyur Gautamo Mabhimrityo Tvat Prasrushtam Mabhivadeta Pratita Etatrayanam Pradhanamam Varam Rune. He says, any child, any good child, any obedient child, any child with the characteristics that our Nachiketa has. See, even before he had concern about his father, isn't it? That is why he said, to whom will you send me to, give me to? He did not insult his father saying, you are doing wrong, but instead he says, whom will you give me to? And behind that question was, maybe the father wakes up to himself and sees that he is doing something wrong. And then when he says that, just before going to the Lord of Death, he said that, where was this verse? Remember how our forefathers acted, consider also how others now act. Like corn decays the mortal, and like corn is born again. That means your actions will determine your future birth. So, dad, beware. But in a nice way he put. Now such a person, when he has got 3 boons, see what he asks. Nachiketa says, O Lord of Death, as the first of the 3 boons, I choose that Gautama, my father, be pacified, be kind and free from anger towards me, and that he may recognize me and greet me when I am sent away by thee. See, in one line, this master stroke he has. It seems very simple demand, but when I start explaining, you see how much he has asked in one boon only. First, First of the three moons, his attention, he knows that he has, the father may have said it in jest, but he took it as the words, final words of his teacher and his father, and somehow doing whatever was required, he has come to the abode of death. Naturally, his father must be worried out there. Oh, because of me the son has gone away, and because of me this happened, and the mother will be fighting and arguing with the father that because of you, you said like this, that's why this happened. And in every family this goes on. And both of he, especially the father, finding that he is the guilty person, having the guilty conscience, he will be unable to sleep at nights and be troubled by the thought of his dead son over and over and over again. Immediately, the first he asks is, may the mind of my father be pacified. Because if his father is not at peace, can the child be at peace? No. So here we see that we must take care of our elders. See, life has put you in a mode of expansion naturally. From childhood, you become teenager, expanded. From teenage, you become youth, expanded. From youth, you become husband, expanded. From husband, you become father, even more expansion. See, so your responsibilities are increasing. But we stop there. And then we fight with our parents and run out of the house so that we don't have to pay the bills of our retired parents. And when we need their help, we come back. Can I come back and stay with you because I don't have a job right now? It should be the other way around. Parents should always welcome the children. That is their job. But as a child, you must serve the parents. You must serve the elders. That is the sign of cultural development of any society. So, we see that our Nachiketa, he utilizes his first boon for bringing peace and joy in the heart of his father. And then he says that, may he be free from anger towards me. So that anger because of which he told him, go, I give you unto death, may that anger also subside, no remnants of that should be there. And then, see the smart fellow, and that he may recognize me and greet me when I am sent away by thee, by you. Meaning, in the first boon, he has taken a guarantee from the Lord of Death that he will send him back to the mortal world where he can enjoy the company of his father and mother, and the father and mother are able to recognize him as he was when he left them. Because the time that passes in the subtle worlds is much faster than on the mortal world, isn't it? So after spending 3 days and nights at the Lord of Death and the conversation going on, how much time has passed? Maybe 5 days, maybe one day, we don't know. But the time scale there and the time scale on earth is totally different. This comes in Shiva Purana, where one sadhaka, one king, or the prince, he meets one Mahatma, and the Mahatma takes him inside the mountain and shows him how the creation is. That yes, that mind can create the whole creation, and he creates a parallel creation to the outside creation inside the mountain and shows him. And they have spent maybe 2-3 minutes inside the mountain and they came out. By that time, 10,000 years had passed. All his brothers who were waiting for him were only skeletons, bones lying on the ground. Time scale is different. So he says that when you send me back from here, may my parents recognize me. It should not be that when I go back, I am still a 9-year-old boy and my parents have become, old and with white hair and white beard. No, not like that. So here we see that only when we are able to give respect to the elders, when we are able to give respect and love, genuine love, to the near and dear ones without any expectation in return, then that love is worthy. Then that love will expand to include even the objects of the world as a result of that. Slowly, slowly, but first, because the first challenge is always our relatives, our parents, our children, our mother, father. They are the first challenge. And if we have not won their heart, when we have not made them proud of their progeny, we have not loved them for who they are, when we do not have the feeling of service and bringing joy in their life by our actions, then what's the point of living? You have again frozen into a teeny meeny ego, which is my way, me and me, me and me and me and me. You have to expand the heart to include first the parents, and among the parents, first Matru, first the mother, and that happens naturally at the child. But after he grows up, then the distance starts coming. So then the father, and then the teacher. So this is the line of expansion. First include the mother in your heart, include the father in your heart, and third, include the teacher in your heart. And when you do, by the time you come to the teacher, along with the teacher comes the entire living creation. It enters into your heart and your mind spontaneously expands into unconditionally loving everything and everyone. And this is the scheme of development of our mind. So here we are just dealing with the first one, that that he took care of his parents, father. It is not who can think about his parents like this? Who can think about his parents like this? Can a runaway from home? You have come across many people in your lifetime. Many your colleagues, many of your friends, or on the TV, in the news, you continuously hear that at the age of 15, 16, they ran away from home. And why? They want to experience the freedom, isn't it? Unconcerned how that mother who has given birth to that child, to me, what she must be going through. And they run away, go away, without even an iota of consideration. Why? Just because they don't want to be, their freedom should not be curbed, they want independence, and for that independence they are not ready to face the conditions within a family atmosphere, and they run away. Such people are immature, don't have the inner confidence to face the situations of life. To deal, life is presenting whatever it is presenting. parents you didn't choose, they were there. Now deal with them in this time itself. If you run away from them, next life again they will come. And the problem will continue. You can't run away from them. Because you have not resolved the problem. You have not expanded the purpose for which you took birth from that womb, from that set of parents, is to accept them, to love them, to serve them. And instead, in the name of freedom, in the name of independence, in the name of what not, you go away. A person who is who has got the inner strength, who has got the confidence, when he is continuously wanting to perfect himself in this life itself, such a person, whatever the challenges come in his life, he faces them head on. He does not run away from them. And that, even if that is the parents. And in this character of Nachiketa, we see that how an ideal child should behave towards the world, and is the child's world begins with parents first. Now, yatha purastad bhavita pratita avdalakirarunir matrasrushtah sukham ratri shahitavita manyuhu tvam drudrushi tvam dadrushivan mrityu mukhat pramuktam. He says, through the Lord of Death says, through my favor, Audaliki, Aruni, thy father, will recognize you and will be possessed of affection as before. When he sees you released from the mouth of death, he will lose his anger and will sleep peacefully at night. So, the first boon, the Lord of Death is also eager to give boons because he wants to atone for the mistake that he has committed in life, inadvertently. He did not know this fellow was coming because he came without invitation. It was not his time. So he has to atone when someone is waiting. That feeling must be there. Like sometimes you come for meditation in the morning and sometimes I get delayed for 5 minutes for whatever reasons. I don't come and say, oh good, you must be enjoying the fresh air outside. No, first is always sorry, isn't it? Same way. He is said sorry, he is asked for the blessings from this boy, and at the same time he is very eager to give him the boons. And he says that the father of Nachiketa, whose name is Gautama, is also known by the name of Audaraki and also Aruni and also Vajashravaha, because he was the son of Vajashrava. So different names. And thus seeing Nachiketa freed, he says, the Lord of Death says that Vajashrava will be happy. Nachiketa, as the first gift, Nachiketa wants the blessing to return to his father. He continues, Swarge loke na bhayam kinchanasti na tatra tvam na jaraya vibheti उभे तीर्त्वाशनाया पिपासे शोकातिगो मोदते स्वर्गलोके. So in the previous two verses we saw how Nachiketa encashed his first blessing or the first boon, and now, and in that he gets makes sure that his father is fine and happy, and he also assures his return into the model plane at the same age that he left it. Smart. Now in the 12th verse, he says, in heaven there is no fear whatsoever. You are not there, O death, nor do they, the inhabitants of heaven, that is devas, that is demigods, fear old age there. Having crossed both hunger and thirst, one rejoices in heaven being above grief. So he's creating a, is it called preamble? Before you make a statement, preamble. He's preparing a foundation for what he wants to ask next. Look at this fellow now. 9-year-old. What he says that in life we see that there is a birth, childhood, youth, old age and death. In a mortal plane, these five stages are there. But in the heavens that we have heard of, that the scriptures talk of, there the first three are present, but the last two are not present. What are the first three? Birth, childhood and youth. After youth, old age and death are absent in the heaven. And this is what we have heard. And also, and what is the grief that man feels? What is the pain that man feels? It is fear of death. Fear of becoming invalid, isn't it? Having a disease. And old age, you are not able to enjoy the world. Your mind is running at the speed of a jet speed. And your body is just... So mind is going, but the body cannot follow. And that's what the story in old age. So, he's glorifying this heaven, this higher plane of consciousness, and compare, and how is he glorifying it? By comparing it to the mortal plane of existence. In mortal plane, there is hunger and thirst, there is sorrow on account of old age and death. Everyone is trying to get away from these two, and heaven is that where old age and death are absent because you are not there, and also you are never hungry and thirsty in heavens. So he says, and having made this statement that he says, Satvam Agnim Swargya Madhyeshi Mrityo Prabruhitam Shraddhanaya Mahiyam Swarga Loka Amrutatvam Bhajante Etadvitiyena Vrune Varena. He says, O death, O Lord of death, thou knowest the fire sacrifice which leads to heavens. Please explain that to me, for I am full of faith, that fire by which those who aim at the attainment of heaven attain immortality. I pray for this as my second boon. If we were given three boons, sincerely, in 5 seconds, you come up in your mind, what will you ask? If Lord was to stand in front of you and give you three boons, will it be pizza, coke and a 70-inch TV screen to watch the matches? Or would it be a soulmate which I have been missing for a long time? No, give me three souls, mate. What will you ask? Prepare. Every now and then ask yourself, what if God came now? What if a great master came in front of me now? Because a master can appear anywhere, anytime. Some of you know that. Baba has appeared to many people at many times. If any master appears, he says, See, I'll give you one example. One boy, you must have seen him because you have been coming for many years to my place. Now he is married and he is living in Glenbeville only. He's bought a house. When he was living with us, he had an interview. He works for RACV now. But that day, he had an interview with RACV. For 1 year, this fellow was going this way, that way, and is not finding a job, is not getting a break into the workforce. Just doing casual jobs here and there, kitchen hand somewhere, but that is not a job. He wants to get ahead. And that day, for whatever reasons, did he remember the Lord? I don't know. He says, I don't know that I remembered or not when he was telling me the story. But inside him, there was an extreme calm. It was an auspicious day. And he was in the city. And from the city, he was coming. He had to get to the RACV office somewhere in Burwood. And there he had to go for the interview for management training. So he was waiting in the city and no taxi was coming. He can't wait for taking a train to get to Burwood because there's no train station there. So he said, I have to take a taxi or I'll be late. So the previous appointment also he was late. That was also an interview, I think. So he prayed to God, Lord, if you are there, if they say you are that, please send me a taxi straight away and help me out in this. Otherwise, I'll miss my appointment and I'm really, he must have gone deep within and knocked the door. And when he opened his eyes, there was a taxi waiting in front of him and a black man in the taxi saying, hey, where do you want to go? He got into the car. He says, I want to go to RACV. He says, and he sat down. And when he sat down, he opened his books because he was getting ready for the interview. Just final things about his profession and all that. So that black man, an African fellow, he says, "You whatever you want today will come true. Ask." So, while reading his book, he says, are you God? He says, do you have any doubt? He's saying, do you have any doubt? And this is a real incident here. Do you have any doubt? He says, so what's your name? This fellow asks. He says, I just told you. But God, come on, man. He says, what, you don't believe me? Whatever you wish today, it will come true. And just like any common person, you just brush it off. He also brushed it off. And before he knew, he was already at the RACV office. He can't remember that journey taken. And he got out of the taxi, stood there. And you know, when you come out of the taxi, you are facing that way. So he put his hand into his back pocket to take out the purse and turned around. There is no taxi and there is no taxi driver. He looked this way, that way, the road is so empty. Where has the taxi gone? And he got the job. But then something remained in his mind. Because that fellow who said, I am God, and who declared that whatever you wish today will come true, then he says, I should have asked for God. See, he's telling me this story after 3 years. He didn't tell me that time, that people might misunderstand and all that. He came in his life. He might come in your life also. What will you ask? $1 million lottery ticket? If God comes and asks you, ask in this manner. He may give you only one chance. He has given 3 chances. 3 opportunities to ask to Nachiketa. But that matured soul, that wise soul of Nachiketa, see how he is systematically conquering every aspect. The mortal, the heavenly, and then we'll see what next. So here he says that you, the Lord of Death, I know that you know the fire sacrifice by doing which one can get to go to heavens. Please explain that to me. And why you should explain to me? Because I have faith in that ritual. I have faith in that fire sacrifice by which those who aim at the attainment of heaven attain immortality. Which immortality are we talking about? We are not talking about the supreme immortality that you have become realized. No, this is relative immortality. Why? Because in heavens you don't die. Gods never die. Isn't it? Have you ever heard of any god dying? Never. They continue to exist till the end of the creation. So there is the relative death that is there for mortal, it is absent for the god in the god in the heavens, because there is no old age and death. So he says that please bless me with that sacrifice. And here we see that any matured seeker, while he is on his journey to know the self, cannot bypass the well-being of his family. Well-being of the family doesn't mean being attached and slogging out for them. No, in his heart, the family, he wants, and the solutions also come. Second, he cannot bypass the feeling of well-being for the society, community, country, humanity. Cannot. You cannot go to a state of realization and abide in that realization without having gone through without having a thought gone through your mind that while I am seeking liberation for myself, let my life be utilized for the benefit of the society. If this interim period till, when will realization go? God knows. It will happen when it has to happen. So till then, am I going to be miserable? Till then, am I going to be, fight with the whole world? No, I'm going to be liberated. Don't disturb me. Don't disturb me. Don't come down. Don't disturb my meditation. No. The reason that Mahatmas, yogis go away from the society and live in a jungle or in a cave is also for the same reason. Because once they know that this is the way they will attain realization, liberation. You have to be true to yourself. It could be by being a mother you want to attain liberation, by being a sister you want to attain liberation, by being a worker in the society you want to attain liberation, by Lehri Mahashay. Was it Lehri Mahashay? Lehri Mahashay. He was a postman during the British period. He was doing his work. But while he is doing his work, he is helping the people around him, and the nights are his meditation. During the day, do the work for the family and for everyone. See? So this transformation automatically comes if you are seeking the highest. And that is first, well-being for the near and dears, then well-being for the society. well-being for the society, this thought will not come until and unless you have taken care of your near and dears. So here we see that Nachiketa in his second boon is asking for the secret of that fire sacrifice by which a common man can attain the heavens, not just him, but a common man can come to know the, come to attain heavens and attain immortality, so to speak. And with this, we see Nachiketa did not ask anything for himself. He did not say, I want to attain heaven. He said, I would like to know the sacrifice. What is that ritual? What is that practice? What is that meditation by which heavens can be attained? I want to know. He did not say, please give me heavens and don't tell anyone, okay? How to get there? No. So, in whichever times we are living, wherever we find ourselves to be at present moment in life, there itself you must determine what your duties are and carry them out to the best of your ability in order to expand, expand and expand. And then, this is a prerequisite for any spiritual seeker. If the well-being of the society is not in your heart and mind, how can you come to know that reality which is all-encompassing, which is all-permeating, which is all-pervading? Think about it. No, no, I don't care for this world. I just want my liberation. It's not possible. So, love for the society. We see wars going on. We see people, the governments doing wrong to the people, religions fighting with each other, converting each other. It's got nothing to do with you. You must accept everything and everyone as they are. A general sense of love should be pervading from your heart towards everyone without judgment. Why? Because the world, modern world has always been like this. You cannot do anything about it. But in your heart, there is only a feeling of, may they all be blessed as they are. Lord, please show them the right way. When we have this type of feeling, the world benefits or does not benefit, that's secondary. But this is for sure that you will get benefited. Why? Your inner environment has changed. Something has transformed. Something has shifted. And that shift is a prerequisite where you accept the entire world as it is without any judgment. Then alone that love for the world, and it's not that you're going after the world, come, I'll help you, come, I will help you, come, nothing like that, and hugging everyone. Not that, but it's a sense of acceptance that the Lord is taking care, the Divine is taking care of one and all. And here, and therefore, our the word Amrutatvam, Swarga Loka Amrutatvam Bhachante, एतद् द्वितीयेन वरे वृणे वरेण स्वर्गलोका अमृतत्वं भजन्ते. Why it is immortal? Because why do we say it is relative immortality, not absolute immortality in heavens? Because actions cannot produce realization. This much you be very clear of. This comes in every Upanishad, it comes in Bhagavad Gita, everywhere our Shankara has, Adi Shankaracharya, he has said, actions are done by a doer, correct? And as long as a doer is, you cannot achieve absolute realization. So if a fire sacrifice has to be done, someone has to do it, isn't it? As long as a meditator is there, meditation will not happen. Meditator has to get out of the equation. Then meditation happens. And to remove that meditator in meditation, we say, come back to the observer, come back to the observer, don't become the observer, isn't it? We keep bringing you back to the source, back to the source, back to the source. So here we see that actions, by actions always some result is created, agree? If I take the, right now, if I do the action of lifting this, the result is that it is not on the table, now it is in the hand. It has moved in space. Every action must give a result. And we are told to do actions without expecting any result. But here, common man, what is he asking for? Let me have a bigger house, let me have good children, let me have enough wealth, let there be no lack of food and drink in my life. May I have good friends, may everyone love me, may I love everyone. This is what everyone is asking. They think by having all this, life will be fine, and this is how it is in the heavens. He who has achieved that on the mortal plane, he is in heaven.
There wouldn't be much growth in heaven then, would there?
In heaven there is no growth. There is only indulgence. In heaven there is only indulgence.
Only what?
Indulgence.
Indulgence.
Only indulgence in satisfying your desires. There is no growth. The only reason we go to heavens, and it's a concept, we go to heaven because of the merits we have gained in this mortal life. And majority of the people on this planet are, we want to do good, why? Oh, I want to go to the heaven. That's it. Why? There's no death there. All my desires will be satisfied in toto. Okay, I'll go there. And they think that is immortality. For many, why only six people are here? In a Vedantic lecture where truth is being told which is beyond the heavens, it is not a tea which will go down the throat very easily. Very difficult to digest that.
So if you have no desire, there's no, we're in heaven already.
Again, as I said, it is a concept. For an intelligent person, if you are miserable here, you are in hell. If you are happy now, you are in heaven. If you are surrounded by people who love you, and you love them unconditionally, and anytime you think of something, somehow the creation comes and satisfies that desire, you are in heaven. So when I saw that glass of water, I was in heaven. We are in heaven. We don't have to worry about breakfast, lunch, dinner. It's been provided. See?
Jesus said the kingdom of God is within you. But I've never heard anyone explain what he meant. They seem to gloss over things like that. And there's no understanding of things.
It serves their purpose. It serves their purpose. So that kingdom of God within you, when you look, understand that from the Vedantic point of view, you realize people don't want to think about that. Or how can that be that there is nothing there and everything there? How can it be? No. There must be a proper place where we can go. And that place is the heaven. Because they can't imagine, because it's not a concept. Reality is not a concept. Reality is not a concept. It's a state of being. It is the only truth that there is. I can't even say it's a state of being. It's just is. So that is missing in many religions except the Vedas. And some great masters who, whether some of them have studied the Vedas and come to be that, and some of the masters without having studied the Vedas, they have intuitively known that and then written about it.
I'm sorry, I missed what it was about.
About the truth. About the truth, the reality.
Mm-hmm. So sorry, I didn't know what she said.
No, don't worry about what she said. Nothing important. Don't worry about what she said. You are on track. You are on track. Come closer.
I reckon you should.
Okay.
Next one.
So when they talk about Amritatvam, it is the heavenly regions where relatively we are immortal. Now, having made this statement and first prepared his grounds in the 12th verse, and in the 13th verse, he asks for that ritual, asks for that sacrifice. See, I was talking about every action must produce results. Even if you say, I perform actions without expecting any results, still those actions will produce some results. Isn't it? And if that result is producing fire sacrifice is an action, a ritual, and by doing that ritual, if you get immortality, as it is given in the verse, does it mean that attainment of reality is on account of action? Which means the reality will have a beginning, and anything that has a beginning must have an end. So reality will become a beginning, which has a beginning and an end. We cannot accept that. So it is told that the immortality that is being mentioned here on account of this fire exercise is only a relative immortality, which is of the heavens. How long do the heavens last? As long as this creation lasts. This period of time, as long as it is, till the final dissolution doesn't take place, till then the heavens will be there.
प्रते ब्रवीमी तदुमे निबोध स्वर्ग्यमग्निन्न चिकेत प्रजानन अनंत लोकाप्तिमथो प्रतिष्ठां विद्धि त्वमेतं निहितं गुहायां.
He says, the Lord of Death says, I know well the fire sacrifice, O Nachiketa. He is inspired, he is happy, which leads to heavens, and I will tell it to you. Learn it from me. Know that it is the means of attainment of eternal heaven and also the support of the universe, and is seated in the cavity of the hearts of the learned. So first the student asked, please teach me the fire sacrifice. Immediately that more than eager teacher, the Lord of Death, who wants to atone his mistake, who wants to give the boons to this pious soul, he said, yes, I know what you are asking, I know it, and I will give it to you, Nachiketa, and I will tell it to you. Learn it from me. Why? If she is cooking, can she teach me cooking? If I don't want to learn? This is where teachers and parents go wrong with the children. Can we teach children if they don't want to learn? Can we feed children if they don't want to eat? One child was there, mummy is putting the food into the mouth, all that mashed food, put in another mouth. Everything coming out. Then again you put it in, again he is throwing out. Again she is putting, again it is coming out. Why you are not eating? You can't even scold because he is so small. Doesn't want. To a child you say, A, B, C. When the child has the urge from within to learn A, B, C, D, when he has the feeling from within, I want to speak like the grown-ups, when he gets inspired from within, then alone he starts learning. First, if the word water is there, first he will say, wah, 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 wah. Then slowly, slowly, after 2-3 months, wada, 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 your tongue is not moving. Maybe after few more months, then wader, wader, or wadal, because r, lot of children, l, they are not able to pronounce. Wadal, 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 wadal. Better. Swamiji, what is this? Wadal. Mummy, Vedi are very happy. This fellow is knowing water. He is saying something very close to water. And then eventually one day, unexpectedly, he gets up from the bed and says, Mummy, water. Ui! Isn't it? When the child takes the first words, how happy the parents are. But that word has not come because they taught him. He is learning. I am teaching, but if you are not available, I cannot change anything. And I cannot change anything. All I can do is share. You have to learn. You have to soak it. You have to become the sponge and take everything that is there for us to give. And that will be directly proportional to your desire to know. See? Who is that? Anyway, so here he says, learn it from me. When we go to the school, the students are so, that student who is very keen and by first time explaining, he is able to understand everything. The teacher is very happy about it, takes him as an example. So he is telling here, learn it from me. Know that it is the means of attainment of eternal heaven and also the support of the universe. This God principle, this Ishvara principle, this total mind principle that we are talking about is the heaven. And to reach the total mind, then we have in many different types of scriptures, there are different levels of heavens, isn't it? So here we are not going through the various levels of heaven, we are going to the ultimate. And what is that total level, total mind? There is individual mind who is miserable, there is total mind who is always happy. Are both are mind, how come individual is miserable and total is happy? Because individual mind is on account of body identification and total mind is on account of total form means the total universe it is identified with. It is the material and the efficient cause of the total creation. So it is pervading the whole creation, the total universe. So therefore, when it alone is that mind which can intuit that it is the source of the entire creation, it is the one who is pervading and in and through the entire creation, the joy, unexplainable joy that comes just by listening to these words, that is what is heaven. So here the teacher says that I will tell, he says, I will tell thee, well, attend to me, learn it from me. Meaning, when I'm telling, be concentrated, don't be distracted. Don't have other ideas in your mind. Be 100% available. And what I'm going to tell, telling can happen only by words. But if you are concentrated and undistracted, then you can catch that which is not given in words also. So we are saying Brahman, we are saying God, but your understanding, you have never experienced God, but you know that God word represents something which is infinitely beautiful, infinitely all-pervading, which is available within and without. Suddenly all this comes to you, and that's intuition at that very moment while it is being spoken. If your attention is not on the word but on what the word is trying to signify,
represent.
Because the heaven is, the words are there for it, but he has never experienced it. So he says, concentrated and be alert when I am teaching. And this is the warning that the teacher gives to the this disciple. And why is this fire sacrifice being told so that you can go to heavens? So that a common man, a mortal man, who is day in and day out riddled by desires for the objects of the world, so that he may replace his mortal desires by heavenly desires and become something more than he is at present. Most of us are stuck in the mortal plane. Me, my child, my job, my house, my driveway, my garage, my bills, my clothes, only my. They don't know that there is a healthier world, joyous world beyond this mind. And for that, some desire has to be instigated in this common man. And if you have to do, you are doing actions for paying your bills, for taking care of your children, for buying a house, for all this, why don't you do actions, just change the quality of the action and do the fire sacrifice? If you do the fire sacrifice, what will happen? You will attain heavens. You do action, what do? You get up in the morning, go to work and work, slog whole day. How much do you get? $500, $300? Per day, if at all. But if the same effort with that diligence, with that concentration is applied to do the fire sacrifice, hey man, you can attain heaven. And we told you what heaven is before, where there is no death, where there is no old age, where there is no hunger and thirst, and all your desires will be satisfied. Oh my God. If at all you have to do action, do this action. Don't do the action of gaining something from the world. So it was for the benefit of the society that this boon was asked. And then where is this where is this fire located? Where can it be caught? And it is seated in the cavity of the heart of the learned. That is where it is. This is a very, the word is, with,
विद्धि त्वमेतम् निहितम् गुहायाम्। निहितम् गुहायाम्, हिडन इन द केव। दिस हैज कम मेनी टाइम्स बिफोर दैट द सीक्रेट इज हिडन इन द केव। विच केव? इन द हिमालयन केव? नो। विच केव? इज द केव ऑफ द इंटेलेक्ट। एंड when is situated in the cave of the intellect, and here intellect or the heart, when the heart and the head come together, that is the point, that is the cave that they are talking about. And it's the secret language that they write this, and here the teacher tells him the exercise. Here in this text the exercise is not given, because fire sacrifice is an exercise, it's an action. And as we know, the Vedas, 70% 80% of the Vedas are rituals, and then there are some concentration exercises, and then the mantra portion, and the last bit, 2-3% or 5% of the Vedas are the Upanishads. So Katha Upanishad comes from the black Yajurveda, Krishna Yajurveda, to which we belong. And in that Veda, again, this ritual of fire sacrifice is already there. So there was no need, because Upanishad is not keen to get into explaining what has already been explained. That they expect that the person who has come to this point of studying Upanishad must have performed all the actions, must have done all the rituals, must have done all the duties. This is just a reiteration to remind the student, I hope you have done all that. So without going into it, Nachiketa is a 9-year-old, he has studied the scriptures, he must have studied it, but did not realize what it is at that time. And when the teacher says, this is what it is, and it must be taken from the, it is situated in the heart of the learned. That means only a learned fellow, only a knowing fellow, person, teacher, can communicate it to you. Not every Tom, Dick and Harry. Nowhere in our scriptures it comes that you can gain knowledge by reading. This I have to say many, 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 many times. And we will continue to say that. Knowledge is gained only through listening to a live, realized master. This thing must go deep into us. So, when he explains it to Nachiketa, then what happens afterwards? The Upanishad continues and it says, लोकादिम अग्निम तमुवाच तस्मै या इष्टा यावतीर्वा यथावा सचापि तत्प्रत्यवदत् यथोक्तम् अथास्य मृत्यु पुनरेवाह तुष्टः। He says, Yama then explained to him, Yama, the lord of death, Yamaraj, he explained to him that fire sacrifice, the source of the worlds, what class of bricks are required for the altar, how many and how they are to be placed, and Nachiketa repeated back to the teacher all as explained. Then Yama, being pleased at this, said again. Now in a ritual, if you have seen when we do fire sacrifice, a platform has to be prepared, and there is a science behind how the fire whole is created. How many bricks on each side, how many levels of bricks, all that is an art. If you see our temples also, temple making is also an art, because the temples, they represent the human being. And in that, some part is the forehead, some part is the eyes, some part is the... And a temple will represent all the five sheets that you have, the physical, the vital, the mental, the intellectual and the bliss sheet. And inside, the where the bliss sheath is, which is dark, bliss sheath is deep sleep state. So if you go to the olden temples in India, in South India especially, the sanctum sanctorum is always dark, no light. You can't see the Lord in there. So when you go to the priest, after going through the seven doors, and you reach there, the priest takes the camphor, lights the lamp, and in front of that sanctum sanctorum through which you are looking, there is only darkness inside. Suddenly, the Lord appears in the light of the lamp. And it's only for a moment. Because he's showing here, then go there, then go there, and then the fire goes away. Again, there is darkness. So here, Yamraj, when he explained, so all these things are required. It's a science and we are not going to go into it. And Yamraj, the Lord of Death, he narrated the whole thing to Nachiketa, and Nachiketa caught the significance behind the words that the teacher was saying, without diluting it. And when the teacher asked, what did you learn, what did I say, he repeated it in toto to the teacher, without missing a single word. And the teacher was very happy. You will be very happy. How happy you are when your child, baby, or now your grandchildren, when they say, what do they call you?
Nana.
Huh? Nana. So instead of mama, they say Nana. You are excited, oh, you called me Nana, and kiss here, kiss there, and hug. Now he knows, Nana, chocolate, Nana, McDonald's, Nana, pizza. And as long as he is saying Nana, Nana will give everything. But if he said, grandfather?
Pa.
Pa, okay. He will say, not today. He knows where to go. But we get so excited when a child is able to repeat. A teacher, when he sees that the student is understanding and is able to reproduce what he has taught without missing anything, the joy of the teacher is even great. The joy of the teacher is when the student becomes the teacher. That is the joy. It is not whether he is bringing water or he is able to sit straight or he is able to do the jobs for me. No. It is when that student is able to communicate that which he has learnt from the teacher to others or to him also. And that comes across every now and then in the interaction. The teacher asks the question, the teacher looks at the person, you come to know where that student is, how much it has been imbibed, how much has been practiced, how much the abidance is there. It becomes crystal clear when you look at a person. So here, the teacher, when he hears Nachiketa, when the Lord of Death hears Nachiketa repeat everything to him as he had told, the joy that he felt of having such a great student He became very excited and happy. And in that moment of love and joy for that young boy, he immediately gives him another boon. See, we also do the same. If you do what I say, I'll give you one chocolate. And if that child says everything, and out of the joy you give him two, no, keep one. Isn't it? So here, the Lord of Death he asked, and then Yama, being pleased at this, said again. Now in the 16th verse, he gives him the second, another boon. Tamabravita priyamano mahatma varam tavehadya dadami bhuyaha tavaiva namna bhavitaya magnihi srunkam chemamaneka rupam gruhana. Being delighted by the response of the student, the magnanimous Lord Death spoke to him, Nachiketa, I grant now this additional boon. This fire sacrifice shall be named after you from now onwards. And take thou this multi-formed and variegated necklace. So he gave him a special necklace as a result of the happiness that he was feeling, and named that fire sacrifice after his name for the eternity. Till this creation is there, this fire will be known by your name. Nachiketa Agni it is called. Now, so here, the Lord Death is as if giving a medal of appreciation in the form of a jeweled necklace. See, Shrikam also means, Shri means garland, and Kam means action, which shall yield many glorious fruits. So when he gave that necklace, it has a double meaning here. And at the same time, action can never, action always gives a fruit. It does not give you realization. So here, in this manner, he blesses the child, and then even though he has given him all the wealth, and he has named the Nachiketa fire, the fire after him, and given him a special gemstone studded necklace, but is Nachiketa accepting it? Oh my God, I am so happy that now the fire will be known after me. Wow, I am really something, and you know, yee-ha, like the kids do nowadays. No. If you are seeking realization, the attitude of renunciation is paramount. Without renunciation, without the sannyas, what we have done is sannyas, renounced. Without this sannyas attitude, without the attitude of renunciation, reality cannot be known. The self cannot be known. So here, when Shankaracharya is explaining, he says that that chain can be a binding also. If so, this teacher, yes, out of happiness he has given him, but is that chain going to bind him, or is that chain going to remind him not to get caught up in the chain? See, in the necklace is a chain. So this type of thought has been presented here, and now the 17th verse begins. Trinachiketas tribhiretya sandhim त्रिकर्म कृत्तरति जन्म मृत्यु ब्रह्म जज्ञम देव मीढ्यम विदित्वा निचाये माम शांति मत्यंतमेति. Whoever performs three times the sacrifice of Nachiketa fire and has been united with the three and has performed the three kinds of duties overcomes birth and death. When he has understood this adorable, bright, omniscient fire born of Brahman, the reality, and realized him, then he attains everlasting peace in the mortal world. So what is this? The threefold Nachiketa fire. It may mean one who has performed thrice the Nachiketa sacrifice, or B, it may mean he who learns, knows and performs the Nachiketa fire sacrifice, or C, since Nachiketa fire seems to be a form of fire sacrifice, the three may mean the usual Grahapatta fire, Ahavaniya fire and Dakshina fire. So when we invoke the fire, when we do Havan, we invoke the three fires. And so maybe those three fires are being talked about. Another way of looking at, then it came united with the three. So what is united with the three again? First, one who has the three great influences is the father, mother and the teacher. So he who has united with the mother, the father and the teacher. United meaning served and is having the love for the three in his heart. I explained to you that in the 2-3 verses before. Who has these? So he who has the blessings of all these three, and as a result he becomes happy. Or B, the three may refer to the three sources of knowledge. What are the three sources of knowledge? There is direct knowledge, knowledge through inference, and the wise words of the saints and sages. So direct experience, pratyaksha praman, inference is anumana praman, and agama praman is the words of saints and sages. And why do we take words of saints and sages to be the direct proof, one of the proofs? And because they have experienced it in their life and they are communicating it to you. So the three, again united with the three, first with direct experience, second through inference also there is no doubt left, and the third confirmed what he has directly experienced with the writings of the realized masters. That is the only way, otherwise how will you come to know? Maybe you are living in your own imagination of realization. So how do we confirm it? Yeah, this is the way. And according to Adi Shankaracharya, it may also mean the three, united with the three means united with the Vedas, which are these revealed scriptures, and the Smritis, which are the remembered scriptures, that is the stories of the Puranas, and the declarations of the realized masters. These three are told, and then the three duties were told. So first was the three, first was the threefold fires that we talked about, then united with the three we talked about, and now the three duties. The three duties, the threefold karma that every Brahmana householder is expected to perform daily are sacrifices. That means every morning he must do a small fire sacrifice, every day he must chant the Vedas, and every day he must give away gifts in charity. These are the three duties that he must do every day. So we light the fire not for sacrifice. We light the fire to light the cigarette. We light the fire to cook porridge or make tea, not for offering to the Lord. And the second is what? Study the Vedas. Means every day, at least 5 minutes even, you must chant the mantras that you have learned. Just it can be Vedic mantras, you know, Om Sahana Bhavatu Sahana Bhunaktu, what we are doing. Om Gananam Dwa Ganapati Gangava Mahe, or any other Vedic mantra. What happens as a result? Those Vedic mantras are formulations, equations with an unimaginable vibration, and they purify. If you do it on a regular basis, every day you are collecting muck from the world, knowingly or unknowingly. But if you get into a practice of chanting, even 5-10 minutes, majority of that is washed away in the pure vibrations of these Vedic mantras. And the last is giving away gifts in charity. It reminds a seeker that nothing is his and everything is the Lord's, and that Lord is this expressing as this creation, so he keeps offering it back to the creation, giving it back to the creation. The attitude of renunciation that we talked about. And this way, here it was told that Brahmajajnyam Devamidyam Viditva Nichaye Mam Shanti Matyantameti. So Brahmajajnyam is the name of the fire, and the knower of that Brahmaja is Brahmajnya. And what is born of Brahman, meaning this world is born out of the reality. Therefore, by doing this sacrifice of fire, one can come to know the total expression of that reality as we experience it right now. With this, we come to the 18th chapter, 18th verse. And I'll do this and then we'll stop. Trinachiketastrayametadviditva ya evam vidvanschinute nachiketam samrityupashan purata pranodhya shokati gomodate swargaloke. He who has performed the Nachiketa fire sacrifice thrice and thus knows the three throws off the chains of death before the fall of the body itself goes beyond sorrows and rejoices in the heaven world. So here the result is being told. What is the result? That as the Lord of Death is saying, that anyone who does this Nachiketa sacrifice three times, and after doing, and while doing, it is not a mechanical exercise. While doing that fire sacrifice, his attention is on the Atma, his attention is on the Self, his attention is on the witness, and he is doing the action. And as a result of that, the meditator, the seeker, shall after death reach the state of total intellect, that is the Hiranyagarbha or the Brahmaloka. Hiranyagarbha is the state where all potentiality is in the seed form. A total banyan tree, a dry seed, it is inert. But when the dry seed has got life in it and the shoot has not come out, the root has not come out, the root and shoot and trunk and branches, everything is in a seed form inside the seed. Unmanifest form inside the seed, but life has started. That is Hiranyagarbha stage. That is the total mind state, which I was talking about last verse. So by doing this sacrifice, a individual mind is able to transcend to the total mind. And there, having reached there means where? The body has not gone anywhere. Here only, in this mortal plane, he is able to recognize that and see himself, his own mind, pervading the entire universe. And such a seeker becomes fearless of death thereafter. And having given this ritual and the meditation that goes with it, the individual ego transcends to become the total ego. Total ego is called the Lord. Another way of looking at it. So, individual ego is miserable, total ego is happy. And total ego is the divine, the Lord himself. And in this way, such a person, when we don't stop here, this is only a relative plane, we are step by step coming to experience greater and greater planes of existences where more and more joy is being experienced. Those who were in the Taittiriya Upanishad retreat last year, we saw the different joys. 100 times this fellow is that, and 100 times of that is the next, and 100 times that. And eventually we reached the Brahmaloka. That Brahmaloka, the ultimate one, is what is being told here. So when we do actions, first the joy from serving the parents is this much. Serving the near and dears, little bit more. Serving the teacher, even more. Serving the society, so much. And slowly, slowly you expand. And when you reach the total expansion, which is the total mind, for such a person, there is no fear of death. He is living in the ultimate heaven there and then. And such a person, at the time of death, for such a person, there is no rebirth. He goes into goes to the heavens and lives there in the divine form with the Lord till the end of time. So this is the Krama Mukti, step by step liberation that was explained here. And such a person, even though expressing through this microcosm, has the experience of macrocosm, the total. And having said this, then the third boon that we will see in the next verse. And such a person who has come to recognize the total mind, because the mind is only one, there is no two minds. You might be thinking, she has a different mind, she has a different mind, you have a different mind, he has 9 billion people, 7 billion people on the planet, and 7 billion minds. Absolutely untrue. There is only one mind. And for that recognition that there is only one mind, this exercise needs to be done. Meaning, see, I understand a little bit differently also, maybe, that this fire is the fire within. Fire always moves upwards, isn't it? It never goes. You have never seen a fire upside down. It's always moving upwards. And when that fire moves upwards, as it moves upwards, it burns away all the cobwebs in, you can say it from various chakras point of view, you can say it from the nadis point of view, you can say, as you allow the fire to rage higher and higher, the purification will be more. So how do you allow it to raise itself? How do you increase the fire? The fire wants to increase. It starts from the base, it wants to reach there, the ultimate, total mind. But every now and then, out of habit, out of desire, out of wanting satisfaction, we keep, through this hole, we keep throwing food and water. and that water, the fire which is continuously burning, gets doused, and all that energy of the fire is utilized to digest the food and evaporate the water, and by the time it starts feeling, oh, now I have done my job, let me move towards my ultimate source and let me become one with the source, and it starts again, the time comes, lunch time will come now, again something will go in, coffee will go in, tea will go in, biscuit will go in, fruit will go in, something or the other is continuously going in, and that fire is not getting a chance to reach its destination. See? So when we allow, by living a disciplined lifestyle, eating very little, ready to live an austere life, and not utilizing that fire into lusty pursuits in this world, then that fire moves up and reaches its destination. And when it reaches here, as it is going towards the destination, everything starts becoming clear in your mind. The destination becomes clear, the goal becomes clear, the path becomes clear, and all you are doing is making sure that the fire is not doused, that it doesn't go away. You maintain the fire. So this morning our Stanton ate very little. You saw? Mm-hmm. Only one toast. I don't know if he has some other stuff in the room. So, but since Friday he's saying, this time on the retreat I'm going to eat less. I want to keep my... This is what you said this morning. I want to keep my energy levels up. That keeping the energy level up means the fire is burning brightly. You have seen fire. When it is a pathetic one, it's just... But when we have done Havan here, you know, once Shivratri, the fire was beautiful, tongues coming out of it. Each one just coming out and wanting to reach. That's how the fire should be from within. It will clean you up. And when that clarity, when it reaches, and that when that fire reaches up, your mind will automatically become purified. You don't have to worry about it. You just maintain that fire. But while maintaining that fire, if some other desire comes in your mind, the energy of the fire will be utilized to satisfy that desire. So here it is told, while you are invoking that fire, while you are doing that sacrifice, keep your attention on the self. Very important. Keep your attention on the self. Not on some desire, not on the body, not on the breath, not on the past or the future, but on the self. And in this way, the seeker is able to go beyond death and recognize that he is the source of the whole creation and pervading the whole creation. His mind, but then the question will still remain, if I am seeing at the total mind level, he sees that the mind is pervading inside also and outside also. Isn't it? Right now also it's your experience. But maybe not the outside, but inside, yes. Your mind is making all the functions happen. This much you know. But now when you reach the total mind, the experience is that the divine is inside and out. There is no doubt about it. And you love everything as it is. And you see the creation as divine, you see inside also as divine. But then the question comes, who is seeing, who is knowing that the mind is, this divine mind is pervading the entire creation and all its levels therein? And that's when that question is asked, then everything stops. With respect to that question, who is that because of who is pervading the entire creation. Who is that who is knowing the entire creation? The third question will be asked. Till now the Upanishad has not begun, only the story is being told. So, Esha te agnir nachiketa swargyo yamavrunitha dvitiyena varena etam agninta vaiva pravakshanti janasaha tritiyam varam nachiketo vrunishva. This is thy fire, O Nachiketa, which leads to heavens and which you craved for as thy second boon. People will call this after thy name alone, O Nachiketa. Now you choose the third boon. In the 19th verse he says, he is keen because I gave you an extra boon. Originally he had asked three boons. After the two boons, he became so inspired that what a fantastic student, he gave one more boon. And a true student will not say, oh teacher, you promised me three, I don't care whether you give me an extra one, I still want my third one. Nachiketa is not that type of a student. The Lord has of his own accord given him the third, an extra boon. Nachiketa thinks, okay, if the Lord has given me, then he is not going to ask for it. But the teacher is more keen that I want, hey, you, I gave you the third, an extra one, but there is still one left. What, ask that third boon. And what that third boon is, we will see in the 20th verse when we come back in the next class. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti 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 Hari Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha Hari Om.